Next, we have item number four on the agenda, ordinance. Now, we, in this case, we have four related papers. Item number 4, 8, 9, 10, actually it's 5, 4, 8, 9, 10, and 11. I'll start with item number 4, ordinance number 2012-193, to amend, reordain ordinance number 2011-70-94, adopted on May 23rd, 2011, for the purpose of modifying the purposes for which the proceeds of debt issuance authorized by such ordinance may be used to include the making of appropriations to the city's economic development authority to be used by EDA to finance capital expenditures or to make loans or grants to finance capital expenditures for the purpose of promoting economic development. Item number 8, ordinance number 2012-213, to accept the deed from the school board conveying 5800 Passing Avenue to the city and to authorize the CAO to act on behalf of the city in executing such deed. Item number 9, ordinance number 2012-214, to declare surplus and to direct the conveyance of the property located at 5800 Patterson Avenue to the EDA of the city of Richmond for nominal consideration for the purpose of the development of the property as an authority facility. Item number 10, ordinance number 2012-215, to authorize the CAO to execute the Lease Street Development Corporation agreement between the city and the EDA for the purpose of providing the authority to develop and manage a training facility designed to accommodate use by the Washington Redskins for summer training, to include two practice fields and a field house to be constructed to the specifications of the Redskins, a sports medicine and training facility designed and constructed to accommodate Mons Cules, Richmond Health Systems, and used by the Redskins during the summer training, facilities for other commercial enterprises that complement the athlete and the health and wellness used by the Redskins and Mons Cules, and other facilities auxiliary thereto or real estate owned by the Commonwealth of Virginia located at either 241 West Lee Street or 2701 West Lee Street or both. And finally, item number 11, ordinance number 2012-216, to amend ordinance number 2012-34-70, adopted May 14, 2012, for the purpose of transferring certain funds and shifting into future fiscal years certain planned appropriations to make an appropriation to the EDA or the authority to develop and manage facilities for commercial enterprises, including Washington Redskins, the Bond Secure Regional Health System, on real estate owned by the Commonwealth of Virginia located at either 2401 West Lee Street or 2701 West Lee Street, or both.
Ms. Robertson, members of the Finance Committee, my name is Jim Duvall, I'm the city's debt manager in the Finance Department. I'm going to speak first on paper number 2012-193. This is a paper that amends an existing ordinance that was adopted, ordinance number 2011-70-94 that was adopted in May of 2011. The amending language is on pages 2 and 4 of the ordinance, where on page 2 it cites a specific section of the Code of Virginia which authorizes cities to make grants and donations and appropriations of money to promote economic development through its Industrial Development Authority. And here in the city of Richmond, ours is known as the Economic Development Authority. On page 4, the amending language toward the bottom of the page is underlined, which merely adds an additional purpose for which bond proceeds can be borrowed. And without answering any questions, it's paper
talk, let me try it this way here. We had very specific projects that were put in these funds. And I'd like to just have a total list of the dollar amount that was projected and what the delta is on each one of these projects. Some of them are, I'm sure, complete, some are not. For example, right now, the jail is the $134,600. Is that a realistic number, or has it been revised upward and downward? I mean, every project of this size has changed.
The total budget for the jail has not been revised.
Okay.
Remember, what we entered into a contract for was $116 million, which Tom is about. $134 is the total budget for the project.
But we're using $134 against the bonds, if my memory serves me correct.
It would be, a project like the jail will actually stretch over multiple bond issues.
Well, and that's what we're...
And some of the funding, in other words, only $106 million that has been appropriated by council thus far, with an additional $27 million to be added to that in the five-year CIP plan for next year. And similarly for the jail, for the schools, they're multi-year projects, which will be end up being parts of several different bond issues, some of which council has not even authorized yet.
And my point is again, trying to get the big picture. I appreciate Mr. Marshall being with me on Saturday, last Saturday. It's been a long week. Monday's short meeting. But the reality of the situation is, as I'm sitting here, and we have numbers on how much we borrow in terms of debt margin. And debt margin, then there's no way around it. And right now, latest projections that I have basically put us in a position that we were going to be very close to bumping our head in 2015, excuse me, at 9.55% on your debt service percent of budget. And 10 is the actual number we're allowed to go to, according to the rules and regulations we've adopted. 2016, we're at 9.73, so we have a less than 2.7 margin. And I'm asking the question about all these projects we have in front of us, the cost associated with them, where we are in relation to the ship, because quite frankly, a few years ago it wouldn't matter because we had borrowed a lot of money, we had a lot of debt capacity available to us. We entered into these projects knowing we were going to get to these. And when you get to a 0.27%, the question then becomes, where are all the projects? And somebody needs to lay this all out and make sure that we're not going over this debt ceiling.
Councilmember, I think those are important concerns. Let me suggest two things that may not be readily apparent in the document you're looking at. One is that the debt we're proposing to issue with respect to the rescue of the bond support facility is revenue supporting debt. It doesn't count against our debt ceiling. So while we issue the debt as revenue supporting, and in our internal rules, revenue supported debt doesn't count against the ceiling. Secondly, we went out and had a refunding in June this past year and have savings in debt service as a result of that, which was reported in the first quarter of the financial report that we sent out. Savings of about $1.9 million. So that equates to 18?
It was actually 1.9. Yes, 1.9.
Which equates to $25.8 million worth of additional debt that could be issued without going over our debt ceiling.
Okay. And where are we in relationship with the projects right now that are under construction? You mentioned the 134, and we're holding there. What about the other projects? I mean, I asked, to get a listing of all this, because again, unforeseen conditions or changes that occurred along the way.
But yeah, I think he's asking a question, are we running over on any of our projects that would require additional borrowing? That speaks to the four schools. The reason I gave you those projects, this is $300 million of the five-year CIP. That's most of the money. So while there may be individual projects, there are another almost 200 other projects. We don't have any projects that are, at this point, showing us a red line that we're going to have to go out and get additional money beyond the contingency that's already in those budgets. So I just don't see it as an issue at this juncture.
What I'm hearing you say, if I may, is you feel that you can take $10 million out of the bonds that are currently in place and basically still cover all the projects that we have on the books right now. I mean, that's what we're doing, because we basically took one, we came together with a very specific number because of that project 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, whatever the number was. We brought it to council, we discussed it, we said, this is what we're borrowing this money for. And here are the 9 projects, or whatever they were, 8 projects, 5 projects. And now you're coming to me, and in so many ways you're saying to me, we have $10 million of extra bond capacity, money available, out of this pool of money that we have.
Yes. And part of this why.
And I appreciate that, but you haven't shown that to me in dollars and cents on a spreadsheet.
What I was trying to show you in kind of a macro, using a macro approach, since this is most of the money, is how our spending is going. Now, the jail, for example, when we put the spending plan together to ask for the authority, we hadn't signed the contract yet. So the construction schedule wasn't in stone at that point. It is now. So we have history showing what the burden rate is on the construction project. That's why we can estimate that we're going to spend 94.6 versus 106.6 in this fiscal year. All we're doing is taking the authority, moving it into next year. And with respect to this new project, this revenue will be revenue supported. So it doesn't require that we issue $10 million worth of new debt to cover long-term debt. We're using,
explain to me,
because if you look at the chart I gave you this Saturday, it shows that in the first 6 years, you pretty much pay off almost all the debt that was issued associated with this project. Because bond supporters agreed that with a 10-year lease, they will front-load lease payments. And we're talking about issuing debt at less than 1% interest in those first two tranches, which is much less than the longer-term debt we would be issuing. 3.5%-4%. So that's why we don't think we're going to run into it. Given the current interest rates, we don't believe that there's going to be an issue. But as it was pointed out by Mr. Johnson, the chair of the EDA, if for some reason this whole thing falls apart by year 10, you still have, you've covered 70% more of the debt already, and you've got a number of decades to get the balance of the money back. I just don't see this particular debt as an issue. Similarly with the schools, you know, the two elementary schools which will open in less than 2 months, they opened January 2nd, we came in under budget for more than $3 million. So we're not harming those schools by moving money into the next fiscal year, which will go to the middle school and the high school. So if we can give you a project with 200 projects, you'd be looking at a sidewalk project here and a paving project and a patching project here. But this is most of the money. It's a bad comparison.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. Sadler, do you have questions?
Lily, yes, you answered the question.
All right, Mr. Marshall, is there other presentations in regards to the other papers that are before us?
There were two papers.
Yes. The other one was
actually the one that was
The second paper I'd like to speak to is item number 11, 2012-216. And we've already touched a little bit on this, but this paper shifts some project spending and authority to borrow money around from the FY13 current fiscal year to the FY14 fiscal year. There's three projects. One, City Council appropriated $400,000. At the time, we did not know the specifics of the location of where the Redskin facility would be located, and so $400,000 was put in the current CIP budget, and so that is a portion of the money that's being appropriated. The other money, as Mr. Marshall had just spoken, in looking and working with the project managers on the schools and on the jail, their spending is in place, and they have projected out what they will need through the end of this fiscal year. And it appears that the funding that they have in place to spend with Laura is in excess of what they will actually spend throughout the end of this year. So what this paper does is ask that council approve amending the CIP budget to move $5.6 million from the authority to build the schools and $4 million from the authority to build the jail out into the next fiscal year. It doesn't in any way change the progress that the project managers expect to make in building the schools throughout the year, but it does move money and authority to spend money out into the next fiscal year, at which time the paper puts the authority right back in the FY14 budget.
The terms of the condition of the $10 million is a recoverable loan, correct? And yes, the question that came up in the meeting and discussion about this previously was whether or not the paybacks on this loan would be in line with the additional funds that are needed when the project gets to that stage of development, as to whether or not there would be any need to go out back to the market to borrow money to cover the gap in between the time of the payments being made back to work as well.
Let me first say that it's under state law, we don't have the authority to give a loan to the union. This is an appropriation to the However, through the cooperation agreement, they would be required to collect rents and pay that money to us to pay the debt service. And they would also be required to pay the expenses. There are two charts here that may help answer the second question that you asked. This is basically the chart we gave most of you last week. The one in $1.1 million in additional sponsorship and rentals. And if you look to your far right column, under that revenue, which shows $5.1 million net revenue. The way these are set up, at the very top you see almost $8.9 million worth of expenses broken, that are related to construction, broken into four different categories. One is city finances, where we finance the site and the fields at $2.3 million. The second, where we finance the sports medicine facility at $3 million. We finance the locker room at $2 million. And the second floor at $1.5 million. Now, it says finance. We're not funding these. We're not paying for them. We are lending the money. And the EDA is responsible for developing the site and administering the site and collecting revenues. So they look like all this. And we and be overall responsible for additional sponsorships. If you look at total revenue each year and compare it to net revenue, you see a cumulative net revenue at the bottom. While in the break-even analysis, it shows that we are upside down most years. By the end of this deal, we break even. So you're upside down in cash. Respect cash. When you see sponsorships at 1.1, you're positive every year after the first year. Now, we didn't come up with these estimates. We had a group, had a committee of folks who do this for a living. Look at what the Redskins have been able to do at their current facility and what other training camps do. They look at opportunities in and around Richmond and estimated actually about $1.3 million. We've actually realized part of that with the naming rights deal put on support. It's actually, which is $550,000 a year. I'm sorry, they say $125,000 a year for the first 4 years, which comes to $3.3 million. So we've already achieved part of what this group said we should be able to do. But to be safe and be very conservative, we cut the remainder of the estimate in half and show that we can still break even.
To some degree, yes, as it relates to this development portfolio. The question that I'm asking is the $10 million, of the $175 million for all of the capital improvement projects that we've led bonds for. Is it anticipated that the $10 million that we will be using as a part of the financing of this deal is not going to be needed to complete those projects that was originally in the portfolio for those major projects? It was suggested that the probability is that $10 million will be needed to complete all of those projects. And there may be a shortfall as it relates to the availability of money for those projects out in years, which means that we may have to go back to the market to increase our leverage of bonding by $2-3 million.
Okay. Thanks. So, A, I don't know whether the $10 million will be needed. We're assuming it will be, which is why we're asking that we amend both this year's budget and next year's budget. This year's budget to add a new project at $10 million. Next year's budget to increase it by $7 million. Right? And the reason I say I don't know for sure is because each of those five projects So I'm assuming we will need the, money, and it might require that we issue additional debt by year. By 15, which is when we have to finish the, we're planning to open the two elementary schools in January 13th, the middle school in 14th. Worst case, you have to issue new debt for the high school in 15, if that were to come past. We just don't know. But right now, what we found is that we've been coming in under budget on the first two schools. And just to reiterate on that part, even if we have to issue additional debt, to the extent that, the $10 million we're asking to use with EDA is funded, is supported by revenue,
right,
it doesn't go against our debt ceiling.
Right.
Right. And that's because my school is a credit tenant. It was, you know, Ellen's Barbershop.
It's a justice good.
I'm sure we can have it. If Byron's Barbershop, it would be bad.
was authorization to convey the property subject to a series of conditions that are set out in the paper. The other paper that contains and deals with the agreement is the cooperation agreement between the city and the EDA with respect to the money that is appropriated to the EDA, which is 215 number 8. That paper does have an agreement already attached to it, just as we routinely do in other cases where we put agreements in place.
To my point, Councilmember Sanders, the agreement that's attached to the paper, I don't agree with it. I don't like some of the provisions in it. And we've already started talking about how we, because one of the issues here is we have two sets of attorneys. We have an attorney in the city attorney's office who works for the, who represents the EDA, and one who represents the city. So I've got to negotiate between the two of them, which puts them in opposition to me also. But I guess my point is, we could end up having to come back 2 or 3 times. Unless we're going to have a lot of special meetings, it would be very difficult to get this done by the first week of December.
Right. And that's why this is such a difficult situation, because we don't want to unnecessarily hold up the process. What we do have to provide the oversight and the governance in this situation. And again, I'm going to let other people maybe talk, not just take whatever that's not myself.
Mr. Stein, I don't really like anything else to ask the question for you to make sure that you're getting an answer to that. I understand that.
I feel like Mr. Marshall gave me the answer. I didn't know if you guys had any desire to weigh in on the problem.
Madam Chair, just asking. So, Mr. Samuels, there will be an agreement attached to this paper.
Right. But probably not the final agreement.
Probably not the final. So what your request is that we would pass this paper with this agreement, and then once the final negotiations were complete, then that would come back again for approval. Is that self-transform?
What I'm asking for is final approval over the agreement, because that by law is what we have to do.
Right.
Now, I think that Mr. Marshall is saying, you guys by law have the authority to give me the authority